It was mid-April when we reached the shores of the Red Sea. We had expected a barren land, but the reality exceeded our worst imaginings. Sand, nothing but sand, and a blistering heat which saps all energy. We made Port Sudan our headquarters. The streets are full of movement and color. In this small town, many races and cultures live together in a picturesque medley. Dominating life in the port are the rich Arab merchants who still practice polygamy. Poor and apathetic, the Negroes from the far interior. Warlike and unpredictable, the nomads Fazi-Wazi. But Islam, the religion of the Prophet Muhammad, unites them all, and they all have the same joyous and childlike attitudes to life and its simple pattern. Just as we gossip in our cafes, so the Sudanese sit in the shade and discuss the latest news. Cotton is still spun as in the days of Sheba's queen. One progressive tailor has modernized his craft, but people still prefer the old hand-woven and hand-sewn garments. You just wait. You'll find you'll be glad of my help. And she was right. In dealing with the natives, she's better than the rest of us. At first, we paid 3 piastres for an egg. Now we pay half, and all the eggs are good. Housekeeping here is not an easy problem. Does this have to be fried? Or boiled? Or is it put in a soup? And they all want to sell. And they all want bakshish. A tip. The white woman gives bakshish. This is our house. One of the nicest in Port Sudan. We have rented it, and it even has its own jetty. We have 2 servants, Oshaik, who is hardworking, and Mahmoud, who is completely idle. It's amazing how religious he is. Whenever there's work, it's time for prayers and his ritual ablutions. Bursting with energy are my 2 diving assistants, Leo and Gary. Keen submarine hunters who cannot wait to be under the water and after the fish. Xenophon, an experienced fisherman and now OC boat, has found himself a comfortable spot where he sleeps at night and breakfasts in the morning. Poor Xenophon. A few days ago, a crab which he ate poisoned his lips. But he bears the pain with characteristic dignity.
Los, Gary, come! Los, los, rein ins Wasser! Hey. Hey.
The left side of the veranda is a special domain of Edward, our sound technician. With the aid of a submerged microphone, we can record the sounds made by the fish as they swim in the harbor, swarming through the water, darting at their food. And these sounds we can send out again through a special loudspeaker. Why are we doing this? Because we believe that fish are not so dumb after all. Because we suspect that in the vibrations made by their fins, certain messages are emitted and received. Because we want to record these vibrations inaudible to the human ear. And where am I, the leader of the expedition?
Herr Dr. Hahn! Hallo!
Herr Doktor!
Here I am, 24 feet down in the harbor. My hobby is the photographing of fish in their natural surroundings. A speckled parrotfish, and there, two angelfish. And here, one of the strangest sea creatures, an octopus. Don't fuss, I'm only taking the distance. Fantastic creatures haunt these waters. A shoal of Fistularia tabacaria.
Dr. Haas?
Hallo, Herr Dr. Haas?
I have no time now. Under the rocks, the water is alive with prawns, crabs and starfish.
Jetzt lassen Sie mich einmal. Frühstück, Dr. Haas!
Hallo, Frühstück!
Breakfast? Well, that's a different matter. A decent breakfast does help along with the work of the day.
Heute sind die Eier bestimmt. Ich habe sie selbst eingekauft.
Bitte, Doktor.
Habt ihr schon Zucker?
And Xenophon thinks that two breakfasts are even better than one. There is no hotter sea in the whole world than the Red Sea, and none more dreaded for the dangers that lurk in its depths. Man-eating sharks and other fierce predatory creatures guard these serene blue deeps where countless secrets are hidden. Beneath its calm surface are coral gardens of fairy beauty and splendor, as yet unvisited by men. Corals. Myriads of microscopic polyps have built up whole mountains. Flower gardens in stone, radiant with every color of the rainbow. And what consummate artistry. Bizarre baroque ornaments, great filigree fans, rosy hues, soft and flexible. Massive globes weighing hundreds of pounds, fluted shapes, curved shells up to 15 feet wide, polyps, avid polyps, incessantly building up great barriers, not infrequently fatal to men. Miles south of Port Sudan, we found the ruins of the ancient port of Suakin. For more than 4,000 years, the colorful life of the East stirred its streets. Now the glory has departed and all is dead. The old palaces which formerly housed exotic riches are crumbling into decay. Hawks, bats and scorpions have made their home here. Not war or pestilence brought this destruction, but coral reefs slowly closing the harbor entrance barred the way to shipping, and thus the city was deserted by its people. We have traveled 3,000 miles to study these mysterious reefs, and here at last we are on the spot. Local fishermen have warned us not to venture into these waters. Not only do sharks abound, but monstrous creatures, horned like devils, sometimes appear. But the water is so crystal clear, so inviting, and who can seriously believe in devils? What peace reigns here. Even the fish seem to eye us with a friendly stare. A many-hued coral fish. What quaint shapes these fish are. One must be careful of touching these corals. Not all are harmless. Some of them have a painful sting. Blood-red coral beds. Coral stars of lustrous blue. And the deeper one goes, the stranger the scene becomes. It's astounding how well Lottie dives. She must have practiced on the quiet back in Europe. Now she's 30 feet down. The pressure in the ears at this point begins to be painful. Five hundred million years ago, our ancestors inhabited the oceans. Since all living creatures, men included, are descended from the protozoa of the primeval waters. Now we are strange intruders in our ancestral home. Naked and defenseless, without scales, without gills, with artificial fins, and with a mask to protect our eyes. Thank you. As in some strange dream, we swim through this mysterious watery world. What is that curious shape? Everywhere in the coral we find these great scallops. They are shellfish, the well-known and often enormous Tridacna. Lutty has also spotted it. She intends to take a whole collection of shells back home.
Was ist denn?
Geh, komm her! Ich hab da eine große blaue Muschel!
Moment, ich steck! Erst noch Fisch!
A dark-colored grouper. Anyhow, the shell can't swim away.
Aber natürlich, Fräulein Lotte. Das werden wir gleich haben.
Die ist sehr schön, nicht?
Das ist ein Prachtstück. Ich staune, dass Sie die vom Boden losbekommen haben.
Und ob ich das habe? Das war aber auch sehr schwer. Sehr schwer.
Telefon, nehmen Sie ab. Aber pass auf, sei vorsichtig, dass sie ja nicht zerbricht.
Langsam. Warte mal, Vorsicht. So.
Herr Doktor, darf ich auch mal die Fotokamera nehmen?
Welche? Die Unterwasserkamera?
Ja.
Sind Sie auch vorsichtig?
Ja, bestimmt. Ganz bestimmt.
Once upon a time, there was a little fish with a large belly. He tried eating less, for breakfast and for lunch, but it was no good. Other fish made fun of him, even prodded him in the belly. And yet, strange miracle, he alone of all his kind is destined for immortality. Thank you. his belly iron record for all time. Now he swims in the developer, 8.5 minutes in a solution cooled to 18 degrees, then twice as long in the fixing solution, which doesn't taste so good. And with this, his immortality is complete. All over the world, people will look at him in newspapers and books. And who knows, one day Walt Disney may see in him an inspiration.
Na, schieße dir Bohne.
Du wirst staunen, wie eine Kanone.
Jetzt habe ich sie, ja?
Das sind Foraminiferen.
Aha.
Has there been a local fight? No, it's Ramadan. The sacred months of fasting. Only the unwitting sheep continue eating. Lottie has invited me for an ice cream at Ramona's. I wonder what's on her mind. There must be something behind this. This is Yanni. Everybody knows him at Port Sudan. And this is what passes for an ice cream locally. Now, Lottie, let's have it. What's it all about?
Herr Doktor, ich habe eine Bitte.
Eine große Bitte?
Ja. Sie haben doch meine Bilder gesehen. Ich würde noch viel bessere machen, wenn ich nur noch tiefer hinuntertauchen könnte. Herr Doktor, lassen Sie mich doch auch im Tauchgerät hinuntergehen.
Es tut mir leid, aber das geht nicht. Das ist nichts für Mädchen.
Warum? Warum soll das eine Frau nicht ebenso gut können wie ein Mann?
Es geht nicht. Wirklich nicht. Die Riffe, zu denen wir jetzt fahren, sind viel zu gefährlich.
Also zuerst muss ich den Atemsack leer saugen, nicht?
Ja, der muss ganz leer sein. So ist gut.
Und jetzt setze ich mir die Nasenklemme auf.
Ja. Sie müssen aber sehr vorsichtig sein und dicht bei mir bleiben.
Ja.
Ganz bestimmt.
Warten Sie, ich gehe zuerst.
One can't argue with a woman. Once she has set her mind on something, by hook or by crook, she'll have her way. And diving with our gear is not without its risks. Pure oxygen is inhaled, and this, beyond a certain depth, can have a poisonous effect. The cylinder valves must be regulated at intervals, or the weight becomes excessive, and down one goes into the depths. Hey, 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 just a minute. Move your fins upward. And we are going this way.
Jetzt kann es losgehen. Bist du fertig?
Moment, hier stimmt noch was nicht.
In Ordnung?
Alles klar.
Also los!
We are in the upper region of the coral, where the light is brightest. The water here is pleasantly refreshing. Lotta seems to feel comfortable. Only the pressure in the ears is giving her trouble. Swallow, swallow! You must swallow to reduce the pressure. Ah, now she has got it. Between the great pinnacles of Montipora, the mountain coral, are excellent hunting grounds. Everywhere are caves and crevices where the fish can take refuge. It's only a question where the big ones are, to the left or to the right. It's a moot point. Less than a month ago, we were walking down the Kärntnerstrasse in Vienna. And now we are promenading the depths of the Red Sea, looking at the corals, just as we looked at the shop windows in the city. Over there is Gary. And a little further down, Leo. And the game is not far off either. A 30-pound grouper. A member of the great family of Ephinephelidae. Feet down. The pressure on our bodies is now 52 tons, enough ordinarily to flatten them out. But since water is the main constituent of the human body, and water cannot be compressed, our bodies resist this pressure with ease. Leo has crept up on the grouper. He shoots! Got it! No, the arrow has come away. A big eel makes its appearance, the dreaded Murena. It wants to know what goes on. Gary has seen it. From behind a coral pillar, he tries to steal up on it. Leo is off to find the grouper, which has rushed into hiding below. The Murena has been well and truly hit, but now how to get it out? No, Leo can't help. He's off on his own mission. Now the Murena is out. Take it easy. Nothing can save you from the stockpot now. And Leo, too, has got the grouper. His fate is a frying pan. Still deeper lies the most sinister region of the reef. We are entering the zone of the coral shells. Thank you. 105 feet down. The pressure on our bodies is now 67 tons. There, a shark. It is the first we meet in these waters. Not very large, just over 6 feet long. But still it's common sense to be cautious. And we must not forget, we are in the ill-reputed Red Sea. Here he comes. Hey, hold back. After all, sharks are among the most dangerous beasts of prey in the world. And there's no telling what mood a shark is in. Mahmoud has a day off. He strolls deep in thought through the park. Obviously, he's pondering some weighty problem. What can it be? In the afternoon, he is seen sitting in a cafe with Abdul Wahab Tahlawe, the wealthy ship owner. Mahmoud seems to have a lot to say. It appears that some business deal is being made. And money changes hands. Next morning, Mahmoud has a remarkable tale to tell. Far out at sea, a monstrous creature has been reported, with jaws white as a church door. Fishermen have seen it with their own eyes. Its horrific head carries great satanic horns. Mahmoud suggests that we hire a large sailing boat and go in quest of the monster. This one's thinking over. It may be a fairy story. Or perhaps he has been promised a commission on the boat. But still, monsters may haunt these waters. What do you think? Should we go? It means a large outlay. And yet, if the story has any truth... Mahmoud introduces me to the owner of a suitable boat. It lies in Flamingo Bay, from where we would have to sail. The price is shocking, but if we do find the horned monsters, our money will be well spent. From all over the Red Sea, pearl oysters are brought here for public auction. From such poor and squalid places come precious gleaming pearls for the adornment of beautiful women. Abdul Wahab shows us the boat. It seems in good trim. Solid timbers and patched but serviceable sails. The captain seems a good man, and the mate too. And the cook plays love songs on his guitar. The deal is done. The ship will be ready in a fortnight. Very well, in a fortnight's time. We use the opportunity to explore Flamingo Bay. Here in the mating season, the golden speckled bream congregate in dense swarms. In a perpetual promenade, they glide along. Bright jewels, light as air. Glittering clouds in the submarine world. Clouds composed of innumerable fish. Sheltering behind a steep wall of coral blooms a lovely flower. This rare species, alive and intact, is worth $100 in Europe. Red firefish, the most poisonous fish in these torrid waters. The natives dread it more than a venomous snake. The lovely feathery fins, which it fans out like a peacock, contains a fiery poison.
Moment, Doctor.
Superb bloom. Tomorrow you will be a passenger to Europe. We need money to pay Abdul Wahab's bill. Mahmoud has taken us to his native village. Our concealed telecameras enable us to photograph the shy natives. Heavily veiled and wrapped in purple and red saris, the women add color to the scene. This is Mahmoud's grandfather, a simple peasant and village patriarch. We ride into another village, 12 miles further to the south. The natives here do not look so friendly. On again over the silvery waves of the summer sea. Mahmoud is taking us to an island where countless seabirds nest. 2 hours at sea and the coast is no longer visible. Ahead of us, the white margin of the island. Mahmoud has not exaggerated. Thousands of birds of various species breed on this island, undisturbed by man. What a pity Lottie and Leo did not come with us. Coral strands, the softest and whitest sand in the world. Coral powdered by the waves. We shall camp here and have a banquet. Mahmoud has promised us a delicious hors d'oeuvre. Xenophon searches for lobsters. I am to supply the roast.
Siehst du sie?
Sie wäre gut. Aber zu weit.
Das kommt drauf an.
Daneben.
Nur immerhin. Mit dem Schwanz hat sie schon gewackelt.
Mir auch nicht.
Das verstehe ich nicht. Das Gewehr schießt schlecht.
Oder du?
Mahmoud has more luck. The bushes are full of eggs. And Xenophon too is successful. A black and green lobster. A succulent dish. The table is set. The feast can begin. Xenophon has chosen crab, of which he never can get enough. And gull's eggs too are tasty, some of them even too tasty. But others at least are good in parts. How do you do, Miss Crab? Your pincers look very chic today. Pyramids on the beach. Crabs carry on the fashion of the pharaohs. Why do they do it? Who knows? As far as we can tell, it serves no useful purpose. Maybe they have tidy minds. Maybe some primitive aesthetic sense. Maybe they just enjoy it. As on land, so in the sea, love plays its important part. Down here too, there are faithful couples, as well as philanderers. This pair of yellow tails is inseparable. I follow them with my camera, but neither fear nor danger will make them desert each other. And not only is there love here, but friendship too. Strange sea anemone, mysterious creature of the deep. You stretch out your greedy tentacles to drag fish to their death. Why do you leave these unharmed? Where all the others perish, these find protection and are even allowed to hide where other fish are digested, in your stomach. Three weeks have passed. The large generator and our equipment goes on board. We make ourselves as much at home as possible, and off we go into the unknown. The heat every day becomes more intense. The air is a fiery furnace. Then sudden rain and storms, navigating difficulties, reefs which we cannot pass. At last the sea is calm and we're in the regions where the monsters are reported. Out here, the Daily Dozen is no longer such a simple affair. The air is so heavy, so soporific, that the slightest movement becomes an effort. The submarine world here is dark and sinister. There is a strange thrill in penetrating these fastnesses where fabulous creatures are said to lurk. A dark, yawning cavity opens in the rocks. Slowly I venture forward into the dim interior. It is a great cathedral below the waves that I have come upon. Light filters in through the high windows. An awful mysticism fills the silent edifice. For 2 days we explored these grottos, and now we move on. Our crew is as thrilled as we are. They are quite convinced that the legendary monsters with devil's horns exist and will be found. Xenophon has sighted something unusual.
Leo, schnell, schnell, die Kamera!
We are ready for instant action. The camera, the harpoon, and Lot in the lookout. Overboard we go. It is a sailfish, a creature only found in the deep waters. Two hours later, we see another monstrous object breaking the surface.
Vielleicht ist es ein Walfisch.
Ein Walfisch bestimmt.
Das ist doch ein Walfisch.
Ja, das ist ein Walfisch mit Hörnern, der Gras frisst und Mu schreit.
Auch eine Kuh.
We continue our vigilant watch for the legendary Leviathan. We must be careful, for no one can tell what peril may confront us at each turn. That fish there weighs nearly 200 pounds, and yet is one of the most timid in the Red Sea, a giant perch. On the western edge of the Tower Teeth Reef, we find a coral wall falling vertically 75 feet to the seabed. Leo wants to set up a record here. He's to try to reach the base of this titanic wall without a respirator. Thirty feet down. Here one must start swallowing to reduce the pressure on the ears. 40 feet. 45. It is a great strain to hold the breath for so long. 55 feet. 60. The pressure on the ears is tremendous. He has reached the bottom. 2, an elusive fish has been circling the boat, resisting all Mahmoud's carefully baited hooks. It's very puzzling. Even Mahmoud, the best fisherman in the Red Sea, who knows each fish by the way it attacks the bait, is at a loss. Sometimes a pull like a cod, sometimes a nibble like a spret. One possession Mahmoud values above everything else, his turban, the wedding gift of his most recent wife. At last the fish is hooked. The secret is to strike hard at the right moment. Now, Xenophon, take a lesson from a real fisherman. Oh my God, what's happened? It's gone! My turban! The devil has had a hand in this. More weeks have passed. It is August, and we still pursue our search for the legendary monsters, which perhaps exist only in the vivid imagination of the fishermen. The heat is intolerable, 110 to 115 degrees in what little shade there is. But we are still determined to go on. For in this unreal world, we have convinced ourselves that these sea devils do exist. They may be enormous mantas. The sharp amber reef, where after 3 months we have now arrived, presents submarine scenes surpassing anything we have hitherto come across. Truly a paradise of fish. Heavy panther rays, well over 200 pounds, glide past us, moving their lateral tips like wings. On the sand below, a Holothurus, a giant sea slug, slimy and contorted. Small catfish standing guard at their holes in the sand. Large groupers lying side by side. And occasionally, a halabi. Very rarely do we attempt to harpoon fish in these waters. For the blood and the struggles of the stricken fish would almost certainly attract sharks or the equally dreaded barracuda. Lati unexpectedly finds herself among a swarm of these pirates. But her movements somehow alarm them, and they pass on without attacking. Like prehistoric creatures, these taurus fish with blue lumps on their foreheads and ugly yellow teeth herd timidly together. An actinaria withdrawing into its hole. And here a huge tropical starfish with 15 arms, all studded with poisonous quills, which curls up like a hedgehog. This place reeks of sharks. Here it is safer to tie the harpoon line to a rock, so that if a fish is hit, it is fast to the coral, and we are free to defend ourselves or to take cover. One shark's already on the scene. And there, second. Careful, Lottie! Careful! One's coming! Keep in cover! Harpoon the fish. Now we must be careful. One of the sharks is already circling the harpoon fish. Leo has abandoned the harpoon and is hiding. But close to the shark, alone and unprotected, is Lati. She seems unaware of the imminent danger she's in. The shark has seized the captive fish. Beautiful. It's Lottie's birthday. Also, Lotte, auf Ihr Wohl.
Danke, Doktor.
Prosit.
Prosit, Leo.
Prost.
Prost, Kinder.
Prost, Lotte.
Prost, Lotte.
Dass dich auch weiterhin nicht die Haie fressen. gut.
The ocean pulses with vibrations. The movements of all the fish create a vast symphony of sound. Is it not possible that fish, with their delicately attuned senses, might also react to our earthly music? We intend to experiment. Will the fish respond to our music? Or will it reverberate unheard and unheeded? Johann Strauss is our choice as a first composer whose music is to re-echo through the seas. His waltzes have enchanted the world above. Now we shall see if his magic is as potent here below. Is it merely curiosity? Or does the music really draw the fish in such numbers to the loudspeaker? In a fantastic ballet, they circle around me and the loudspeaker.
Hinunter?
Ja. Ich gehe unsere Männer besuchen. Ich möchte auch sehen, was Fische zu klassischer Musik sagen.
Werden Sie sich aber auch binden?
Oh ja, ich binde sie schon.
Na, seien Sie bloß vorsichtig. Tauchen Sie nicht zu tief und denken Sie an das Sauerstoffventil.
Keine Angst. Versunkenes Schiff. Dort unten liegt ein versunkenes Schiff. denn überhaupt? Ich muss hier weg. Mein Gott, ich muss hier heraus. Wie komme ich denn hier heraus?
Wann ist sie denn hinunter?
Schon vor einer ganzen Weile. Habt ihr sie denn nicht gesehen?
Nein. Wir müssen sie sofort suchen. Los, Leo!
Leo, gib die Kamera her! Schnell, schnell! Den riesigen Schmied! Der ist mit der Bude! Los, Leo, schnell!
A gigantic bulk is moving beneath the surface. It is a creature such as we have never before seen or imagined. A shark weighing several tons. We approach it from all sides. It is a whale shark, the largest shark in the world, which attains a length of 60 feet. For only a few minutes, we are able to observe it closely, and we make good use of the time. Close to its vast underside, several suckerfish swim along. This shark is monarch of the waters. He regally ignores us. Now he sees me. And his eye goggles. At point-blank range, I photograph that mighty mouth. Truly a yawning cavern. Mahmoud did not exaggerate. Slowly, majestically, Leviathan disappears. Never, as long as we live, shall we forget his sight. Suddenly, another monster comes into view. A great, shapeless mass.
Leo, Leo, hierher! Hier sind Riesenrochen!
They are devil rays. Stupendous mantas. Creatures never before photographed in the sea. Only a moment ago, we met the world's largest shark. And now we have chanced upon the largest species of ray. Take care, Lottie. Such huge animals can only be harpooned with a long line. You take the camera, and I'll try to get one. No wonder the natives call these mantas devils. They really have what appear to be two horns on their heads. Curved flaps on either side of the mouth.
Gib mir die andere Harpune. Die mit der langen Spitze.
Hier?
Ja, die.
Again. The hide of these rays is like a coat of mail. And once more, Lot is in grave peril. She has gone off by herself again, and two enormous mantas head directly for her.
Achtung, Fräulein Lotte! Ich schieß!
Straight over Lottie crashes the intense creature. This was our last and culminating adventure. Now we turn for home. Mahmoud is proud and delighted to have shown us the cavernous jaws and the horned devils. Be sure, Mahmoud. One day we shall return, for innumerable secrets still hidden in the oceans spur us to their unveiling. We sail on with the whispering breezes. The seas are our hunting grounds.